Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Well, here's a panel I was hoping wouldn't come for another 30 years. Someone once wrote, when someone you love becomes a memory, that memory becomes a treasure. And here today, we're here to celebrate the treasure that was Carrie Frances Fisher. You know what? I have to tell you, I have been trying to deal with this. You know, there's the five stages of grief. And just when I think I've gotten to acceptance, I bounce back to anger. Because I'm mad. She should be here. She made every celebration so much more fun. She deserved to be here. Wait till you see her in Last Jedi. You're going to love her. But I'm still not thinking of her in past tense. Certain people have a vitality and an energy that's so strong, it reverberates far beyond their lack of physical presence. You have to forgive me because... I actually looked up, what is a tribute? A gift? A compliment? Given as due? An expression of gratitude or esteem? And I have to tell you, Carrie would want us to be happy. She wouldn't want us to become consumed by grief. She was all about having fun every day, finding fun, finding her own fun, which is why it was such a joy to be around her. Well, most of the time. Because, you know, when we found out in the storyline that we were brother and sister, we were more like brother and sister than we realized because we loved each other, but we fought and we criticized and we were judgmental and we'd get fed up with one another. By the time they told us that we were going to be brother and sister, you see, they took us aside and they said, I said, this is going to be something, because last time they pulled me aside, they told me he was Dad Vader. And Kirshner said, now you know, and George knows, and I know, so if it leaks, we know it's you. What a burden that was. I had to keep that a secret for more than a year. So they brought us into the dressing room, and they told us, this is during Jedi, because there was a mock scene with the wrong information, and they said, Luke and Leia are twins separated at birth. And, you know, I was stunned. I'm 5 years older than Carrie. And I said, well, wait a second. Let's see, if I'm Luke Skywalker from a moisture farm on Tatooine, and she's Princess Leia, does that make me royalty? And without missing a beat, Carrie said, no! I said, okay, I'm just asking. But that was sort of a clue into how much she reveled in being not only pretty much the only girl in that galaxy far, far away at the time, but her exalted status. And when you think of it, she was true Hollywood royalty. I was one of seven kids from a middle-class family. You know, she was the daughter of two big stars. You know, so it was fascinating for me to discover the world that she had lived in. We became such great friends. Let me tell you about the first time I ever met her. We decided to have a dinner together in London because we wanted to meet each other before we started to work. Now, we did all the stuff in Africa first. Sir Alec went there, Tony and Kenny Baker, the droids and so forth. All the Desert Planet material was done. Then I came back, and then Harrison came, and we worked with Harrison for a while, but she was the last piece of the puzzle. And I arranged to have dinner with her, and one of the production assistants, who's still one of my best friends today, Peter Cohn, he had a car, so he drove me to the restaurant, and as we were walking in, I said, "Hey, you know what would be fun? Introduce yourself as Mark Hamill, and I'll introduce myself as Peter Cohn, production assistant."
It'd be really good and
funny. So we go in and we sit down, and I'm telling you, imagine meeting her for the first time. I was unprepared for, I was just bowled over by her humor and her wit, how sardonic she was, how dark she was. You know, within 20 minutes, she was telling me stories, personal stories about her mother and her father that I wouldn't have shared with you if I'd known you 10 years. I'm going, yikes, do I have to know this stuff? We were so taken aback. We sort of forgot our little joke. And of course, Carrie, in this mad world of creativity, she didn't even notice when we said, "Oh, by the way, we were kidding. He's Peter and I'm Mark." And she said, and then continued. So all that planning, she was much more entertaining than our lame joke. But, and then I'd have to tell you, people say, "Was she your best friend?" Well, no, I don't think so. I mean, the thing that she had about her that no one else could match was that she made you feel, when you were in her presence, like you were her best friend. She was so laser focused on you and so engaging that it was like exhilarating to be around her. Just a shopping trip was fantastic. I would spend the day with her on a weekend, and I'd go back to my flat, and I'd be exhausted. I think, wow. She was like 24/7, always on the go. The moments I remember is when I had her to myself, you see, like that Saturday where Terry O'Neill took all those pictures, the one where I'm holding the lightsaber and holding her and she's being the damsel in distress. It was all day long. I think we had like an 8 a.m. call and we'd shot until 6 p.m. and she was all mine. I didn't want to share her with Harrison. I didn't want to share her with anybody. And at the same time, as attracted as I was to her, I thought, I couldn't handle her as a girlfriend. She's too much. I mean, she's what you call like a high maintenance relationship. And also, I had an experience. It's not easy. There's lots of, romances that happen in the theater, in television, in movies. It's just natural. I mean, that's where you meet people. You fall in love at work, whatever your work is. The dangerous thing about this profession is, say you're on a TV series and you have a relationship with a cast member. If that relationship goes south, you might have 2, 3, 4 more seasons with somebody that can't stand to look at you. I was living with the girl that got cast as my sister on a soap opera. We pretended like we didn't know each other when we auditioned. And we read, because we had different agents. I said, "Let's pretend we never met. How do you do? How do you do?" And we read the scene, and we "Gee, you kids have a tremendous amount of rapport with one another." And we were like, "Well, we're just good actors." Now, of course, once we got the part, after a few months, and they started sending scripts to the same address, in those days, it wasn't okay. I mean, we're playing brother and sister. Now I'm sure they do incest plots and they can do whatever they want. But in those days, the producer, Jim Young, said to us, look, if we see pictures of you in the fan magazines holding hands and, you know, smooching on the streets, I'm going to have to fire you because people will be really turned off because it smacks of incest. So that's how innocent it was in those days. But I made sure, I tried to resist every impulse to avoid, you know, and I did fall in, part of me did fall in love with her. I think every guy that she met, I've heard Dan Aykroyd tell stories, I've heard Paul Simon tell stories, you know, she had you under her spell. And sometimes, you know, we sort of wanted to go in that direction. I mean, on the pretext of talking about kissing techniques. Well, I'm a pretty good kisser, you know. Oh, I think I'm a better kisser. Cut to us making out on the couch like a couple of horny teenagers. And I'll tell you what really cooled it was the fact that at some point we both started laughing. Believe me, that's a real... it kills your passion. If someone's laughing in your face. But I thought, we dodged a bullet there because we had the fun without any of the responsibility. But right after we finished filming, again, I was completely under her spell. I went to Beverly Hills. I went to where she lived with Debbie and Todd. I saw the mansion. I went to a birthday party where everybody there was, that's Dean Martin's son, that's Lucy and Desi's kid. You know, everybody was somebody nearly famous. I was the only one there I'd never heard of. And you walk through the parking lot, and it looked like a car dealership for, you know, the Maseratis, Lamborghinis, Mercedes-Benz. You know, I had sort of a beat-up Mazda that I parked down the street so I could arrive on foot. I'm no fool. But again, it was such an exotic life, you know. I'd been in the business almost 7 years, but I just had never met kids who grew up and gone to Beverly Hills High and just had that as part of their life. And then when I was in New York, I visited Debbie in her apartment there. When Carrie found out I was staying in a hotel, she said, forget that, you're staying with me. And I moved in with her and her roommate, Griffin Dunn. She was like that. She was so giving, and she had fun around me. I had fun around her. Like I say, a relationship that's that sort of passionate, you know, and I don't mean that in a physical sense, but just in our emotional sense, burns very brightly and sort of by definition has to fizzle out. By the time we got to Empire, you know, so much had changed. You know, Harrison had moved on from his first marriage. I was married and expecting our first child. Carrie had a boyfriend. We all had managers and agents and things that we didn't have before. So there was something about the original film that will always be special because we were babes in the woods. We didn't really know what was going to happen. But one of the things I'm most grateful for, because there were long stretches, we get fed up with each other. And I remember we were doing the bikes in Jedi, and we'd be up on these bikes, and they say, if you kids could just stay up there between takes, it would save us a lot of trouble. We're almost ready, and so forth. So Carrie, under her poncho, would pull out volumes of philosophy. Kierkegaard, Nietzsche, and she had a highlighter pen, and she's highlighting all these things. And I was sort of insulted, because, you know, in the old days, we would have been... It's like when we were doing the swing across. We were hooked together and we loved it. We were just had so much fun that day. by that time, we'd sort of evened out, and she was, I'm sure, you know, found me extremely tiresome. But, and I was mean, because I knew that in her trailer, she had the National Enquirer, she had the Star, she had all the tabloid rags. And I said to her, gee, Carrie, why bring Kierkegaard on set when you have the National Enquirer in your trailer? And she barked at me, because I want people to think I'm smart. And it's interesting, because she didn't graduate from high school. She went into Irene, her mother's show on Broadway. So here she was like 16, 17, in the chorus of a Broadway show. And even that, to me, because I hadn't done Broadway at that point, and I found that endlessly fascinating. Oh, what a great life. I much rather had been in a musical comedy than in the 11th grade. It seemed so exotic and so magical to me. But, you know, today is a day where it would be very easy to be consumed by grief. But let me tell you, when I go to sleep at night, there's never a day so far where I don't think of her. And when I think of her, and I hope you can appreciate this mental image, she's looking down from the celestial stratosphere with those big brown eyes, that sly smile on her face as she lovingly extends me the middle finger. And that's how I want you to think of her. That was Carrie. She'd be having a great old time. I remember talking about one of my favorite scenes in Tom Sawyer. I think it's chapter 16, 17, where they think Tom and Huck are dead. And they sneak up into the balcony and watch their own funeral. Mark Twain was so brilliant. What a premise that is. Because it's like these people that die and then they give all these awards. Why didn't you give him an honorary Oscar when he was 87 until waiting until he was 91 and dead? Because at the funeral, everyone's talking about Tom and Huck. Well, they were such good boys. They had so much promise. They were never treated well when they thought they were alive. But that's when Carrie looked at me and said, I promise you, if you go first, I'll heckle your funeral. That's quintessential Carrie. It's so irreverent. It's so funny, the concept of someone heckling your funeral. And he said, promise you'll heckle mine. I said, oh, you got it, babe. Well, that's one promise I won't keep. But we have a few people that have some memories of Carrie as well. But first of all, in case you missed it, let's take a look at the tribute reel that we played yesterday for any of you that might have missed it.
Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope.
I love these movies, and actually they've become better for me now because I have a daughter and she loves them.
I love that Princess Leia was a very strong woman, and I adored how feisty Carrie Fisher was.
Well, you can't top that. It reminded me the first day she worked was the day we were running down the Death Star after releasing her from her cell. And by the way, when I read the script, I thought nothing defines the princess more than the fact that we risk our lives to board this technological marvel of a Death Star, find her cell, extricate her from that cell, manage to get her back to the Millennium Falcon, and she looks at it and says, you came in that? Come on. That's the princess. And it reminds me of my sister saying, "Dad, can you drop us off a block away from school?" Remember my Mazda story? Everybody wants something they don't have. But we were running up and down the Death Star. And again, she's so much fun. It's a great way to, while away the time when filmmaking can be tedious. You know, you have to take take after take and then different angles and whatnot. And all of a sudden, she wasn't around for a while. I said, "Harrison, where's Carrie?" "I don't know." I went, "Well, I know she's somewhere, but are we, because we can't do anything with just the two of us." And she came back, and she's had this sheepish look on her face. And I said, "What happened?" She said, "Well, Gary said I was flopping." And I said, "What are you talking about?" She said, "When I'm running up and down this Death Star, he could see I was flopping around." And I said, "This is the origin of there's no space, there's no underwear in space." Because I said, "Well, what do they do?" She said, "They taped me down." So now try and watch that movie again without thinking of her with gaffer's tape. She was adorable. I mean, and perfectly, as I always figured, we must have been cast in scale, because Harrison's this tall, I'm this tall, and Carrie's 5'2". And there's nothing a man my size enjoys more than a diminutive woman, because it makes you feel tall. And she was so challenging, you know. I mean, we both really had a love of the absurd, of Monty Python, and she was very knowledgeable about film. She'd seen so many of the movies that I loved. Jealous that I got to work with Alec Guinness and she didn't. I said, "Yeah, but you got to work with Peter Cushing and I didn't." But she also said to me, "I wish I could go back and do that scene again." I said, "What scene?" And she goes, "I really overdid the English accent. I thought I recognized your foul stench when you came on board." And I said, "No, it's perfect." She said, "Well, I was working around all these English actors," and she had gone to the London School of Drama, so she had been hanging, you know, all of her classmates were English for the most part. But she got self-conscious about it. And that's what I loved about her. I think I said in a tribute that, again, when this happened, I said, "Well, that's it. I don't want to talk about it." And they said, "No, you have to talk to the press. Just make one statement and then you'll be done with it." And one of the things that I said was so true. Do you want me to read it? Because I can annotate it a little bit. This is like too soon. This is like a week after it happened. I said, "It's never easy to lose such a vital, irreplaceable member of the family, but this is downright heartbreaking." I don't know if I can read this. "Gary was a one-of-a-kind who belonged to us all, whether she liked it or not. She was our princess, damn it. And the actress who played her blurred into one gorgeous, fiercely independent, and ferociously funny, take-charge woman who took our collective breath away. Determined and tough, but with a vulnerability that made you root for her and want her to succeed and be happy." That's what I thought was so incredible about her. For all the bravado, it was almost a defense mechanism, you know, that she wore this toughness like armor, but down deep there was that vulnerability of a little girl. It's enormously appealing. And she's so smart. You know, "You call this a plan? Give me that gun." You know, she made Solo and Skywalker look like chumps. No one had probably ever challenged Han Solo, least of all, she was 19 years old. 19! I was a worldly 24, of course. But that's what I thought was important, that it made you want to root for her, but it made you want her to succeed, and you wanted her to be happy. It was so hard to put this to words. And honestly, she played such a crucial role in my life, both professionally and personally, and both would have been so diminished had she not been a part of my life and my career. I am grateful for the laughter, for the wisdom, and the kindness, and even the bratty self-indulgent crap. See? Siblings to the end. I had to put in a little... Even the bratty, self-indulgent crap my beloved space twin gave me. So thank you, Carrie Francis. I love you, Mark. Now, okay, remember... That'll always get you out of your... Because you know she's loving all this. It's just too bad that, you know, because she was really at a point in her career where she was about to really reap the benefits of being an elderly character actress. There's a show in the UK called Catastrophe, where she could, where she could really be that... And it's a phrase she used, crusty old broad, that always lurked inside of her. I found it remarkable when I would visit Debbie and Carrie, because Debbie was bouncy and optimistic and fixing my collar and asking me, are you eating right? Carrie would shuffle in the slippers going, hey, Mom. Puff, puff. You go, who's the daughter and who's the mother? But I think there are other people that we should get to who have some remarkable memories. Here's one from the master himself.
I was talking to the casting director, and I said, I want somebody very young. I want somebody 19, 18 years old. And she's a senator. And she's very powerful, and she's very strong. She has to be morally and emotionally strong and be able to take charge of everything. And so that was a huge challenge for all of us, to find somebody like Carrie, who there's nobody like Carrie. Very few women could carry off the particular kind of strength that she had. I did not want to put boys' clothes on a woman. I wanted a woman who's a woman who was very strong and wise and a leader, and at the same time, young. You know, because the big issue is, well, how can a 19-year-old be a senator? But I believe that 19-year-olds are smarter than most people. And Carrie proved that.
Yes. You know, I finally looked at the screen tests that were on the DVD extras. I was home at the flat one day, and the whole family went out shopping or something, and I came across auditions for Star Wars. I thought, ugh. Do I have the nerve to watch mine? And when I watched them, I watched Robbie Benson, and I watched William Catt, and I watched... from The Thing. He's such a good actor. Kurt Russell. And every one of them would have been great Lukes. You know, and I finally watched mine, and I thought, well, good. I wasn't pushing too hard. Sometimes if I really want something, my neediness bleeds through. The best thing you can do, by the way, if you're an aspiring actor, is pretend like you don't want it. It's like the girl that won't date you in high school. You want her more! But I thought, well, that's good. I was sort of relaxed and laid back, so I'm happy about that. But I thought, he must have just thrown a dart at four pictures on the wall, because they all would have been perfect Lukes. Later, I heard from Marshall Lucas that, as he said, it was about chemistry, and that there were a final Luke Leahan and a Luke Leahan, and they never mixed and matched. It was always Carrie, me, and Harrison, and the other three. So he was packing to go to England, and he still hadn't really decided, and Marcia told me that I said, that's the group to go with. And look at how everything changed. I was reading a book about the Monkees, and Mickey Dolan said, oh, I'd been up for three or four pilots that year, and he went out for the Monkees. And he said, can you imagine one single audition that changed your life forever? I said, oh, I think I can imagine. So I got to watch time, because we have another memory that I think you'll enjoy. We have that queued up?
So the last time I saw Carrie was actually in November. I went over to her house because I needed to show her the last shot of Rogue One, which we had done as a computer-generated shot, and she hadn't seen it finished yet. So I got to the house, and typically she would always want to go to the back room where she had it decorated with all sorts of wild stuff and neon signs and whatnot. So she was talking a mile a minute. We got back to the back room. I opened up my laptop computer and set it down, and she said, so what are we going to see? And I said, well, you're going to see the finished shot of yourself at 20 years old. And she said, oh, okay. So I rolled this shot, and she looked at it, and she didn't say anything right away. She just kind of leaned back, sort of stunned. And then she goes, and I'm sorry, I can't say this completely, because if you know Carrie, she dropped the F-bomb several times. So she said, oh, my effing God. And I said, yeah, it's pretty amazing, isn't it? And she said, yeah, I can't believe it. And then, typical with Carrie, she jumped up, changing the conversation, because usually when you get to know Carrie, she was always bouncing from one conversation to the next. It was very tough to keep up. So she reaches over and she grabs Princess Diarist, which is the book she had just finished writing and she was promoting. And she said, she looks over at me and she goes, I think Harrison's really mad at me. And I said, and I paused just a little bit too long. And I think she actually didn't want to know what I thought. But she carried on and she said, I'm going to autograph this for you. And I said, okay. So she grabbed her copy of the book and she autographed it. And when I got out to the car and I was getting ready to head home, I opened the book and she had written in it, you are my only boss. Thank you for not firing me. And I burst out laughing, which that was Carrie. She was always funny.
All right. Let's thank Kathy for not firing her, by the way. I started getting this sort of laryngitis in the middle of the day, and I thought, this must be psychosomatic, because this is looming, you know, to have to try and use you as therapy to get through this together. It's nothing that I anticipated, and like I say, she wouldn't want us to be consumed by grief. She was all about laughter and laughing. And thank you for not firing me. It reminds me of one of my favorite Kinks lyrics from Celluloid Heroes. I wish my life was a nonstop Hollywood movie show, a fantasy world of celluloid villains and heroes, because celluloid heroes never feel any pain, and celluloid heroes never really die. But reality has to butt in and ruin our dreams. Because Carrie will always be with us, probably stronger than ever before, because you never miss something like you do when you don't have it anymore. I know I did. And one of the things I was so grateful for, because we had a long stretch where I didn't see her for many years. Occasionally we would, you know, she would have a charity and I would donate signed items or vice versa. And we were perfectly friendly. We weren't just hanging out anymore. So the great gift of coming back to these movies was the fact that I could reestablish my relationship with her and sort of make amends, because, you know, there were rocky times, and I don't know how if it ended well or not, but, you know, it was like being in the original band. You know, we had a big hit record, it went supernova, and then we all went solo, and we had our highs and lows. But she was there from the beginning. They asked George Harrison, what was it like to be a Beatle? He said, what was it like not to be a Beatle? Because that's all he knew. And here she was, 19, barely out of drama school. Star Wars was my first movie. I'd done lots of television and TV movies and soap operas and so forth. But little did we know how this would take hold and go on and on and on and on and on. Oh, that reminds me. We were in Westwood when we heard that the trailer was in the movie theaters. We didn't see any commercials on TV, by the way. I never saw a commercial for Star Wars before the movie came out. And I watched Saturday Night Live every week, believe me. But we walked by the Abco. Carrie was always getting me to do crazy things. In other words, if you see me in that floral robe walking around the desert, that was Carrie's robe. She goes, you put it on. And I just, without thinking, I did it because I wanted to please her. And this was funny to her. She thought of me as like her own personal paper doll, I think. One time when they were filming Empire, now remember, I'm off with Yoda on stage, whatever it is, and she's in the Millennium Falcon on another sound stage. And she comes, we met in the lunch hour, and she said, try on my space suit. And I said, what are you talking about? I can't get in that. She's petite. She goes, you can get in. And she had one of those clown heads with the glasses and the nose and the big bozo hair. So she said, put this on. And she was dressing me. And she says, now put on my space jumpsuit. I said, Carrie, I can't. Put on my space jumpsuit. And I said, okay. And I'm stretching to get into this thing, you know. And it's like really tight. I had to suck it in the stomach to get it zipped up. And I look like an idiot. You can imagine. It was just skin tight. And I could hardly breathe. And I had this stupid thing. And then she took me by the hand and walked me all around the studio. Like I was some mental patient on an outpatient basis. And I don't think I would have done that for anybody but her. I was always doing whatever she wanted, you know? I mean, because she had that sense of absurd, and I thought, you know, don't be such a stick in the mud. Nothing pleased me more than hearing her laugh. And a lot of times you'd say something and she'd go, funny, without spontaneously laughing, which was odd. A couple of the things that I said to her wound up in her books without being accredited. And I'd go to her and say, Carrie, I said that to you. And she, did you? I don't remember that. But, and you know, you look kind of small. Arguing over something that you said years and years before. Another example of things where she drove, and I got to go fast. there's figures of us at Madame Tussauds Wax Museum in London. And I always thought, oh, wow, that would be mind-blowing to go see yourself in wax, because we didn't pose for it. They did it from sculpture and, you know, measurements and whatnot. So I emailed her, Kay Carey. We were in a contest to see who could get over 1 million followers on Twitter, see? And I was pulling all these stunts, you know, episode 8 trailer, you know, everything. I lost all my credibility because I shamelessly was lying through my teeth just to get my followers up. And I said to her, by the way, I said, if you'd stop using those emojis, I said, it takes me half an hour to read whatever you're writing. You're so witty. You're so funny. But if it takes me more than 30 seconds, I'm moving on. You know, I don't have the time. But anyway, I wrote her and I said, hey, this would be great. Let's. My daughter Chelsea figured out when it closes. We called the museum. They said if we show up at a certain time, a certain date, we can go in after it closes so we're not a distraction. And I'll pose with your slave Leia. And you can pose with my, you know, whatever I am. I think it's the Jedi scene in black. I said, well, explode the internet. It'll be great. And I didn't hear back from her. You know. So about 2 or 3 weeks later, I'm going over to her, you know, checking out to see if she's gaining on me. She was like 60,000 ahead of me. And I look. There she is at Madame Tussauds. Posing with slave Leia. Posing with Luke. I said, I am so mad. I mean, the next day at the studio, I went right to her trailer, bum, 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 bum. Yes, come in. I said, Carrie. She goes, what? I said, you stole my idea and you didn't even invite me. She goes, what are you talking about? I said, I thought it would be great if we both went to Madame Tussauds and posed with the wax figures. And she goes, oh, that's a great idea. We should do that. I said, you just did it. It's too late. Oh, never mind. But she had this sort of innocent thing about, what are you talking about? She goes, is your name in your email, Mark Hamill? I said, no, my email is something else. She goes, ah, that must be it in a minute. Like she would have answered me if Mark Hamill was in the email. Okay, we're getting very close. Let's get to a clip. Oh, let's get to a person who will give you his own perspective on his introduction into the world of the Fisherdom, Warwick Davis. The time flies.
It does.
So sorry. Oh my gosh, it's 8:20 and counting.
But what I will say, sitting back listening to your story, is absolutely wonderful. To get such a personal insight into Carrie and your relationship working together on the films has been absolutely wonderful. You'll all agree with that, I'm sure. I mean, it's absolutely wonderful. And such a fitting tribute as well to celebrate Carrie in this way.
Right.
For me, my first memory of Carrie was when I was 11 years old and very new to the film industry and never been on a film set before. But what Carrie did was just made the whole experience for me fun. It wasn't intimidating. It wasn't daunting in any way. It was just fun.
Right.
And, you know, being inside an Ewok costume, you get very hot. And I remember every time I took the head off, Carrie would be there checking I was okay.
Aww.
She'd have chocolate milk, she'd have cookies,
yeah.
You know, whatever she thought I needed. And she kind of became a very sort of on-set mother figure to
sure.
me. But yeah, I just remember her humor and just making the whole experience fun. I mean, that's a very candid piece of video there.
Right.
Some behind-the-scenes footage.
You were such a breath of fresh air because this was the last film. It was almost like your senior year in high school. We'd become sort of jaded and anxious to move on to the next thing. And he shows up roller skating around the studio, flying around. And, you know, we all went back to our best behavior because it was an outsider. Because we had sort of fallen into bickering and, you know,
yeah.
it's inevitable when you're in a group that long. So it was such a joy to have you there.
Well, you all made me feel so welcome. I mean, absolutely. I mean, it was a great way to be introduced to this industry, of course. You know,
and it's been downhill ever since.
Absolutely.
No, that's not true. There's not a movie in England made anymore that doesn't have Warwick in it. He's in all the Harry Potters. He's in more Star Wars movies than I am, that's for sure.
Well, something else I'd just like to say, and a piece of video I want to introduce before I go and leave Mark to wrap up the show, is many of my fond memories as well of Carrie more recently have been on stage at Celebration events. Now, as Mark's already mentioned, she loved Celebration. She loved the fans. I mean, for any of you who ever met Carrie at a Celebration or a convention anywhere, you'll know she had so much time for the fans and just loves to celebrate the films and her character. And I spent many a happy hour on stage with Carrie. And I cut together a short highlights reel of our time for you all to enjoy here this evening. So we'll take a look at that.
Please give a royal welcome to a new Disney princess, Carrie Fisher.
Since we last chatted, you've been working on The Force Awakens. We can now talk about
it. I'm not allowed to talk about that.
You are now, though.
That one.
Yes,
okay,
the one.
I don't know what I'm not supposed to talk about, but I know it's something.
The picture there will remind you of that moment. So
I know, that's my baboon-ass hairstyle. You don't disagree. First I have the hairy earphones, and now I have baboon asses.
Do you have any advice for the younger members of the cast?
I've told Daisy not to go through the crew like wildfire. It is very weird to be merchandised. But I liked being a shampoo where you could twist off my head and pour liquid out of my neck.
Oh.
What are you doing, you nervous little thing? I need subtitles for that.
Yeah,
No, don't be scared. Don't be scared. I have a Coca-Cola for you.
Oh.
Now, I have to make him not nervous, so you stay unnervous.
Okay.
Here, look, it's just a hat shaped like glasses.
And then there's a big explosion.
Yeah, there's a big explosion.
Pew! Quick, hide behind the sofa. Oh. If you just shut your eyes for a moment, when I come back on, I'll say open them, and I want you to say the first thing that comes to mind. Okay, open your eyes.
There's always a bigger fish. You know, when we were doing the scene in the trash compactor, there was a thing that was supposed to be called a Dianoga. That was the thing under the water that grabbed Mark. And so we're in the trash compactor, and Mark lifts up a piece of trash and says, "Pardon me, George, could this be Dianoga poo-poo?" I'm always Princess Leia. I mean, if I ran into one of you, would you call me Carrie or would you call me Leia? Both. That's true. I am Leia and Leia is me. Let's call the whole thing on.
And I mean, I just want to say, I mean, Carrie's spirit and humor was so strong and so vivid. It's like she's still with us, isn't it?
Exactly. She is still with us. It's like I was saying, it's impossible to think of her in the past tense because she made such an impression on us. She is so much a vital part of this series. You know, her legacy will last forever.
Absolutely. Well, thank you very much
for
having me out here, Mark. Thank you.
Warwick Davis.
Thank you,
Warwick. We've got to get to the Rian Johnson clip just in time. We're under the wire, but here's a memory from our current director, Rian Johnson.
So one thing I knew as a Star Wars fan is that on the original movies, and Carrie would say this a lot, like one of the big directions George always gave was just faster, more intense, and that was the direction. So there was one day when I was directing her and I was giving this very articulate, ornate direction, and I was really getting it like very deep and psychological and describing motivations and this and that. And I got to the end of this long, flowery piece of directorial nonsense, and there was a beat of silence, and then she goes, "So faster, more intense." And I said, yeah, faster, more intense. Yeah.
Well, listen, I want to thank you, because this is part of the process that I need to move on. I tried very hard, but you know, we lost Kenny Baker and Carrie in such a close period of time. You know, but she loved you, and I certainly love you, and I need your support, and we all need each other's support to make sure that we honor her legacy in a way that she earned, in a way that she deserves. And I'm thinking of one last quote for you, and that is, "As long as we live, so too she shall live, because she has become a part of us all. And we'll never stop missing her." Thank you so much. Thank you, Carrie. Thank you. Carrie, thank you, and I thank you.